Good afternoon to one and all. We at the Center for Constitutional Law and Policy, Parul Institute of Law, Faculty of Law, Parul University, wholeheartedly welcome you to our first big event as such for the center here at Parul Institute of Law. And today's topic is something which is really very interesting, very contemporary as well. It is based on COVID-19, that is the management of the COVID-19 pandemic by the World Health Organization. We have got here welcome back, Mariangela Barletta, who is a PhD student in public comparative and international law with a special attention for human rights and the international order at Sapienza, University of Rome. She particularly researches on topics related to international health law and gender studies. For this, she is also a professor assistant in a high specialization course at the University of Sapienza, the role of women in the conflict resolution. After a degree in law with full marks and honors, she went for different internships, such as at the procurator's office of the Italian Republic, in law firms, in research centers, and NGOs also abroad. Recently, she is focusing on COVID-19 issues from different perspectives, and that is why we have her here to give all our students and viewers a deep insight and analytical view of the role played by World Health Organization, which is a very, very important international body as far as even international law goes. So, Mariangela, big welcome to you. Welcome back, rather. So, All up to you, Mariangela.
Thank you, Faiz. Thank you, Parul University, for this invitation. So I'm going to share some slides in order to explain a bit what is happening in this situation and how the World Health Organization is managing this situation. Tell me when you see the screen. Okay.
It is visible, yes.
Okay, so from the beginning. Okay. I will talk first about the COVID-19 pandemic in general, then the WHO mechanism, then the member state obligation, but also the WHO obligation. And then the actual issues, such as the obligation of states and this violation, and the problem of vaccines. So, COVID-19 was declared a pandemic by the World Health Organization the 11th March 2020. But we have to say in general that this is not the first pandemic. So, in 2009, WHO declared another pandemic for the first time, and it was in that case H1N1. Of course, there were other emergencies, sanitary emergencies, such as SARS, MERS, Ebola, Zika, but not like a real pandemic. So let's see what is a pandemic for the WHO. So according to WHO definition, a pandemic is the final stage of an epidemic. An epidemic is the occurrence in a community or region of cases of an illness clearly in excess of normal expectancy, while a pandemic is an epidemic occurring over a very wide area, crossing international boundaries and usually affecting a large number of people. So, in order to protect the right to health overall, after the World War II, the United Nations approved in 1945 the proposal to create an autonomous organization. And this organization is the World Health Organization. The World Health Organization, so we should say that protect right to health. Right to health is provided by many international documents. For instance, the most important are the International Covenant on Economic and Social Rights of the 1966, but also others, like for example, the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, CEDAW, and the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disability or of Child. It is important, the most important, I think, is the Article 12, because it is said, declares, that state parties to the present covenant recognize the right of everyone to the enjoyment of the highest attainable standard of physical and mental health. It is important to remind this, because it is present also in the World Health Organization preamble of its constitution. In fact, the constitution, in the preamble says that the most important thing is to prevent pandemic or epidemic and to protect the high standard of health for everyone. The World Health Organization was founded in 1948 and is a UN specialized agency with a general competence in the health field. Its main goals are to ensure the highest standard of health to population, to coordinate governance in the health field and policy, to promote the collaboration among member states, to provide information and recommendation to states, and to inform the public opinion correctly. So the preamble, as I was saying, is a state of complete, according to who, defines health as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being. The enjoyment of the highest attainable standard of health is one of the fundamental rights of every human being, without distinction of race, religion, political belief, economic or social condition. WHO is divided in six regions. So the region of Americas, the Eastern Mediterranean region, African region, Southeast Asia region, European region, and Western Pacific region, with the specific competencies. Let's see the bodies. So first of all, there is the World Health Assembly, which is the supreme decision-making body of WHO. It also appointing the general director, and it is composed of 194 representatives from each member state. So it adopts treaties and guidelines, even if they are not binding. Then there is an executive board, which is composed of 34 members, qualifying the field of health, and then the secretariat, which comprises the general director and technical staff. Okay, here we can see the function of the assembly. In particular, the assembly shall have the authority to adopt regulation concerning sanitary and quarantine requirements and other procedures designed to prevent the international spread of disease. Also, according to Article 23 of its constitution, the assembly shall have authority to make recommendations to members with respect to any matter within the competence of the organization. The most important document of WHO, except from its constitution, of course, is the International Health Regulations, IHR. The first IHR was adopted in 1961. With the aim to minimize disruption to international travel and trade and upholding human rights. So, the IHR was the first universal and coherent legal regime of surveillance and control of infectious disease, which replaced the previous sectorial treaties. The actual IHR was approved in 2005 and adopted in 2007 by state. The new international regulation includes the list any disease irrespective of original source. So also, for example, chemical weapons, while the previous one provided only cholera, diseases such as cholera, malaria, poliomyelitis, neither HIV. The new regulation aims to strike a fair balance between sovereign rights, human rights, freedom of traffic and trade. And this is, I think, important to underline, because when we think about the World Health Organization, we think only to protect human rights, to protect health, but it's not only like this. Also, it's important to protect the aim of the WHO is also to protect trades. because if states close these boundaries and put people in quarantine, it's difficult to change and to commerce and trading products. So the regulation also tell us that states have to develop certain minimum public health capacities or capacities in order to limit disease and control points of entry. Also, it says that homes who have to determine a public health emergency of international concern when there is a risk of an epidemic, for example, in the case of COVID-19. So now we can analyze how states and who cooperate. According to Article 4, each state party shall designate or establish in its nation a national focal point. Also, who shall designate a contact point, which shall be accessible of all times for communication with the national focal points of each state. This kind of cooperation is really important and essential in the case of a pandemic. In fact, in this case, and this is what is happening in the case of COVID-19, states, according to Article 6 and 7 of the regulation, shall notify WHO by the most efficient means of communication available by way of the national focal point and within 24 hours of assessment of public health information of all events which may constitute a public health emergency of international concern within its territory, in accordance with the decision instrument as well as any health measure implemented in response to those events. According to Articles 10 and 11, also WHO, when there is this notification by states, has to verify and investigate, also through non-official fonts, the situation, guiding the states in deciding if it is necessary to declare an international emergency. We had a scheme here. Okay, so now we can see what is a declaration of public health emergency of international concern. So once WHO received the notification, WHO may authorize the Director General, according to Article 12, to declare a public health emergency of international concern and to issue temporary recommendations that are not binding to for the states. Public health emergency of international concern means an extraordinary event which is determined as provided in this regulation, HLC, to constitute a public health risk to other states through the international spread of disease and to potentially require a coordinated international response. Of course, it is sufficient the potential risk of transmission to declare a HLC. The Director General shall consider, according to Article 12, any information provided by state party that have the duty to notify to WHO. Also, he has to listen to the advice of the emergency committee, and then it has to identify scientific principles as well as the available scientific evidence and other relevant information. Also, an assessment of the risk to human health, of the risk of international spread of disease, and of the risk of interference with international traffic. So, an emergency committee in this situation plays an important role. We say that the Director General, when there is the declaration of a pandemic, may adopt temporary measures in order to guide states. According to Article 15, these recommendations are not binding documents and they may include the following advices according to Article 18. For example, implement quarantine or other health measure for suspect person implement isolation and treatments where necessary of affected persons, refuse entry of suspect and affected persons. So this is the scenario that we saw during the COVID-19. It is important to underline that states can also choose to adopt additional measures during the international pandemic declaration under Article 43. Such measures shall not be more restrictive of international traffic and not more invasive or intrusive to persons than reasonably available alternatives that would achieve the appropriate level of health protection. But during COVID-19, something went wrong, especially in this sense, so in the sense of the Article 43. In fact, first of all, we have to say that it's okay that according to Article 43, states may adopt additional measures, but this measure may not be excessive discretionary. For example, in the case of COVID-19, there was an excessive discretionality. Moreover, in the sense of quarantine and to protect human rights. But also, there was a lack of adequate information and transparency by China. In fact, China was accused of censoring and withholding information, violating, as we say, its duties in Article 6 and 7 to notify, and also delay in declaration of the pandemic of international importance by the General Director and Emergency Committee. And this was also a political problem. So the problem, this was not only a structural problem of the regulation, but also a political problem because China members were present in the Emergency Committee. So, according to Article 43, numerous nations implementing travel bans, discrediting the guidance issued by WHO. And we will see if this is a violation of international law, if we can consider it likely a violation or not in a while. But firstly, I would like to focus also in the protection of human rights, because it's true that states, in case of emergency situation, may apply certain measures that restrict the human rights. But this measure may be applied under strict condition, in according to many treaties, for example, the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the American Convention on Human Rights, and European Convention on Human Rights, because they have to notify when they apply some measure and also which kind of measure they are applying in their territories. Also, some human rights, which are defined with the term use cogens, cannot never be limited and must always be respected by all. In the case of COVID-19, unfortunately, many states didn't respect both the duty to notify the type of measure they were applying in their territory, and also they violated some important human rights that can be included in the term use cogens. So, which are the consequences and the perspective? Unfortunately, we can say actually nothing, because according to the regulation of WHO, they don't provide an accountable mechanism, and so it's not possible to use sanctions against states which don't follow the WHO recommendation. The first reason, the most important, is because, as we say and as we see, they are not binding, so recommendations are free to guide the state. So may we consider these violations as a violation of international law? We can say that probably yes, if you consider the regulation under the Vienna Convention of Treaties, because according to Article 31, state must act according to bona fides principles. So, okay that the recommendations are not binding, but it would be nice if you are part of a treaty to respect its principles and its rules. So, however, who cannot adopt countermeasure according to Article 56 that was never adopted till now, it is only possible to appeal to the public naming and shaming procedure, but till now we didn't start any procedures like this. Finally, we can consider the problem of busing, because it's the actual one. Who recommendation may also be related with the buttons. In this sense, for example, who publish recommendation and guidance on developing a national deployment and vaccination plan for COVID-19 in November 2020, updated in June. This guidance is built to prevent the violation of human rights in order to ensure to everyone to access to vaccine, but also in this case, state, according to Article 43, are applying other measures that are disaggregating the WHO ones. So we are assisting again at the same problem that we have in the first phase of the pandemic. So the problem now is still open. We have to wait to see what will happen and if the vaccine will be enough for everyone. But meanwhile, there, we have to say that it's not possible to sanction states or to start some mechanism of sanction against them. So now, if we can finish, and Faiz, if you have some questions.
Yeah, sure. Thanks a lot. So really interesting insights by you. Just a few questions. You mentioned about public health emergency, right? So does the WHO or any of the international law protocols actually define or lay down any benchmark that this is when you can declare public health emergency? Is there any criteria for that? If you could just throw some light on that.
Yes, the criteria is to the emergency is to be an international emergency, but in general, there is not a real requisite that we can find. It's something that it's up to the general director and the committee. So it depends case by case to understand how huge is the problem and how the spread might be fast. So it's just an investigation and a decision made case by case.
Right. And you also discussed something on the minimum public health capacities, right, which should be developed. So, okay, this is a broad policy at the international level, but do you see any kind of uniformity in this across nations, across states? Because we live in a world whereby the countries can broadly be divided into developed nations, developing nations, and lesser developed or least developed nations, right? Yes. You can call them by various other names as well. So how do you see this getting uniformly implemented, if at all, if it's possible?
Yes, we can say that there is an uniformity across states, unfortunately, even if that was the aims of the International Health Organization. Even if there are core capacities, the duty to implement core capacities, often there is a lack of money. So there are not investments in this field of health. Because thanks, we can say, to this pandemic, this is the first time that there is such attention in this topic. So probably it is going to be better in this sense, but we are only in the beginning.
Right. So as far as the role of the WHO goes, they did declare a public emergency of international concern. So do you think sometimes it is very easy to criticize WHO, the way they have handled it, but do you think sometimes a lot of undue criticism is thrown at them? Do you feel that the governments across the world, maybe they are more to blame than the WHO itself for the situation we find ourselves in?
You mean that states prefer to not apply a declaration of pandemic?
Yes, and maybe not taking the warnings from the WHO seriously.
Yes, I think it's an economic problem. So this declaration is the last thing that in general states, but also who decides to do, because it's really problematic from the trades and commercial perspective, that as we say, it was one of the principal aims of the WHO constitution, so to protect, yes, health, but also trades. So I think states are a bit blamed, yes, you say right, for this reason.
I believe as per the constitution of the WHO, I don't think there is anything more which the WHO can declare. I believe the public emergency of international concern, that is the highest form of emergency as per the various levels of emergencies laid down in the constitution of the WHO, right? So I believe they laid down the warning that this is something big, and there is nothing more they could have done to actually warn the states in this regard, I believe.
Yes, and this is weird that, as we say, that normally is the general director to declare an international pandemic of international concern, but this is not provided into the constitution. So it is something like, it used to be like this, but it's not in the constitution. So this is weird, because it's not provided there.
Right. So there were a lot of concerns at the domestic level, at the states level. Like if I give you the example of India, we invoked the National Disaster Management Act. So this is a 2005 legislation, whereby it gives, as I told you, that we have got a federal setup, right? We have got the union government as well as the state government. So it gives a lot of overwhelming powers to the union government to carry out things in case of such a disaster. But at the same time, we also had something called the Epidemic Diseases Act. And this was a 19th century legislation, still existent. It was formulated in 1897, way back. So it is still existent, and that particular legislation actually catered more to the states. It was more in favor of the states. So there was, to an extent, a little bit of overriding going on between the two legislations and the two sets of governments also. So this thing sometimes works out in favor, sometimes it doesn't. I don't know what it did in India's case. So even the local issues, certain very niche issues, certain very localized issues which are there across states, they play a lot of a big role. WHO is there to warn you, it is there to give you funds in case if it's required. Many top scientists and doctors from across the world are a part of the WHO, but I don't think at the ground level you can go about and just blame WHO for the mess which was there some time back. Now situation is better. So what's your take on that? Would you be defensive of the WHO in this regard, or would you be offensive?
I think I may agree with this. And we had something like this in Italy also, but probably in India, I didn't know the situation, but now that I listen to you, I think that this contraposition between co-legislation and India legislation sometimes may create problems, probably. According to who, they prefer to promote the legislation in the territory. So the territory legislation prevails. In the case of Italy, we have problems because we didn't have a proper legislation in this case. So we had to use the guide of the recommendation of who. And these recommendations sometimes were not clear, sufficiently clear. So, for example, medical associations starts to promote their own rules, and these rules were there were problems to understand the value of these rules. So, were they were binding or not? And in case of violation, what were the sanctions in case? So, I think in India the situation was better in this sense because at least the situation was defined in certain sense. So yes, I think this.
So the point which you just mentioned, what do you is this very very Italy specific point, or would you say that this was pretty much similar for entire Europe?
Could you repeat the phrase? I didn't listen.
Yeah, yeah. The point which you just mentioned, would you restrict it only for Italy, or it is more or less the case with the entire Europe?
The governments in Italy restricts, yes, not only the Italian territory, but everything in Europe, because there is also the European legislation to manage the situation. So in this case, we were restricted in our territory, and it was not allowed us to travel. So it was the same as the rest of the world, I guess.
Right.
Yes, the problem in Italy was that the measure was excessive. So, and there was really a huge differences between large cities and small cities. So this was the main problem, I guess, also for the protection and the development of personality of people, and to protect their human rights, for instance, job opportunity, to search job opportunities, or to enjoy a dignity life. So people who were living in a small towns really start to suffering for depression. For example, they couldn't move for months. So I think this was really a problem. I don't know if India was the same, but probably was the same.
Yeah, that divide was definitely there, which you talked about. Yeah, here as well. Going back to the international level, you believe the Security Council, the United Nations Security Council, it needs, or it needed to play some sort of an active role in this, or do you think that no, it is out of their jurisdiction as such, there is nothing which they can do about it? What's your take on that, since we are discussing it in terms of international law and you being a scholar who is into international law as well? So what's your take on that?
Yes, definitely the role of the secretary, it's really important in this sense, because it is provided also in the many treaties that he can introduce additional recommendation in this sense. And he did it. And but the situation didn't change, so Actually, we can say nothing about, but yes, the general the secretary can act and can do something in this case. The main problem that was discussing was about the responsibility of China in this sense. We have to say also that we can do nothing actually against China. Firstly, because according to Article 43 of the regulation, states may put additional measures. So even if, for example, in Wuhan, in the beginning, they put excessive measures, who can do nothing in purpose? Also, the penal court can't act against China, because China is not part of the International Penal Court. So it's not only possible to start an investigation against the fact that happened in Wuhan, that in the beginning was like known as a poliomyelitis, so not like COVID-19. Also, it's not possible to act against China because China is part of the United Nations, so of the five most important states of the Secretary. So actually, against China, it's impossible to put sanction of something, neither in this case by the Secretariat of the United Nations.
Yeah, interesting. As far as one of your slides go, you mentioned about vaccination as well, and the role, the active role of the WHO in that. So there is a lot of discrepancy as far as the dissemination of vaccines is concerned, or the procurement of vaccines is concerned. If you have a look, certain really developed nations, they have got around 4 to 5 times the doses of their entire population already with them. And on the other hand, some of the nations, they don't even have a single dose for each of its citizens at this point of time. So this raises certain concerns, even if you talk about the ICCPR, which you mentioned in the beginning, rights pertaining to equality at the international level. So in this contextual framework, what I just laid down, what would be your take on ensuring vaccination for everyone, basically? And yes, if you want, you can add the role of WHO as well in that.
Yes, and in this sense, it's really difficult to ensure vaccination to everyone. And this is the actual problem, according to WHO also, because in this recommendation, WHO provided that vaccination shall have been distributed conformly to everyone in a nation. Of course, this is not happening, actually. Firstly, because there was initially a division to, for example, younger or older people. In some cases, the vaccination started from older. In other cases, it was chosen to start from younger, or workers, or social workers in the field of health. But the real problem is that in some cases, vaccines are not arriving neither in the territory. We have to think, for example, in some states of African territories. I don't know in India how is the situation, if you have vaccination through all the territory. Here, for example, in Italy, we are vaccinating all older people first, and then we are degrading to youngest one. So, but of course, the real problem is in the not developed country, in which there are economic interests. So we may think, no, as we say in the other webinar, in the situation of Israel-Palestinian conflict. For example, in that case, Palestinian people is having a lack of vaccinations because it's a duty of Israelian, according to the Convention of Geneva, to provide vaccination to the occupied territories. So in that case, there is a lack of the international law and the international protection of human rights law. So how is, for example, in India, the situation?
The strategy was more or less similar in India as well. So we started off with vaccinating the 45 plus population, first of all. Firstly, it was for the medical professionals and then gradually to the 45 plus professionals. And now, since the last few weeks, we have opened it up to 18 plus. So anyone above the age of 18 can get themselves vaccinated. So it's broadening the scope now. The indigenous production is there here, but of course the population, it's a big challenge here. So to cover the entire population, that's a big challenge. So yeah, hopefully by the year end, as per the statements of the government, everyone should get vaccinated. So this is how the plan is. So yeah, really interesting insights from you, Mariangela, as far as today's topic is concerned. You laid down the international framework, first of all, the broad international framework on the ICCPR, ICSCR, and then you gradually went on to the WHO and their constitution and what is their role in general. What do you mean by a pandemic, an epidemic, and then a pandemic of international concern, a public health emergency. So those points were really well covered by you. And then, of course, the actual role of the WHO in the management of the pandemic. And you also talked about vaccinations, which is quite relevant now, which is very important thing. So it was really a really good presentation. I am sure all of our students and viewers would definitely have gained a lot out of your presentation. So thank you so much, Mariangela.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And if you want to ask me something, you can write me also. People are watching us. So I will, I'm glad to answer to some doubts.
Yeah, I'm sure they will shoot the doubts at you. So thanks a lot, Mariangela. Really happy to have you once again. Thank you so much. Looking forward to many more collaborations and, you know, this almost becoming a second home of yours, so to speak, here at Parul University. Thank you so much.
Thank you to you. Bye.
Bye.